Film Guy Recaps here. Don't forget to like and subscribe. Film Guy Recaps here. Don't forget to like and subscribe. Nick Dunn is shown in the beginning of the movie caressing his wife Amy's hair while pondering what she is truly thinking about. Nick is spotted visiting the pub he co-owns with his sister Margot on July 5, 2012. She fetches two glasses and fills them with bourbon. Although she is attempting to lighten the atmosphere, Nick is upset about something, and today is Nick and Amy's fifth anniversary. He has no desire to return home. A flashback clip from 2005 shows Nick and Amy meeting for the first time at a party. After the party, they go for a walk and engage in nice small conversation. They walk by a bakery that is receiving delivery of sugar. Under the night lighting, sugar particles floating in midair appear fantastic. They kiss in this bizarre moment of closeness. On the anniversary, Nick can be seen coming home in the present. As soon as he walks inside the house, he screams out for Amy but gets no response. He notices that the glass on a table in the living room is broken and that it has been overturned. He yells Amy's name so loudly that a neighbor is shocked and hears him now that he is panicking. Nick phones the cops right away. Officer Jim Gilpin and Detective Rhonda Boney arrive at the house and immediately start the inspection. In the kitchen, Rhonda sees a blood stain above the counter. They see images of Amy's parents' well-known book series, Amazing Amy, on a wall in the living room. Rhonda remarks that she enjoys reading the books and finds it surprising that Nick is wed to Amazing Amy. Nick is taken to the police station shortly after to be questioned over Amy's disappearance. It seems strange to Rhonda and Jim because he appears to be apathetic and reticent when responding to inquiries regarding his wife's disappearance. Amy's blood type and even her close friends are unknown to him. Nick stays at Margot's house after being questioned as the police examine his residence. Noelle Hawthorne, a pregnant neighbor who claims to be Amy's best friend, stops by and asks the police about Amy. Officer Jim discovers an envelope in a closed drawer in the bedroom. Clue 1 is written on the envelope. Nick explains that Amy made this hint as a part of an enjoyable treasure hunt for their anniversary when asked about it. They follow the first clue to Nick's office, where they discover a pair of red lace pants. A brown house is mentioned in the second clue there. They eventually locate the third clue when they visit Nick's father's residence. But Nick can't make sense of it. Amy's parents arrive from New York shortly after, and a press conference is arranged to raise notice of Amy's absence. Nick smiles next to the Amy poster and asks others for aid, but he comes across as soulless and just makes himself look worse. Rhonda meets with the parents of Nick and Amy in order to identify potential possibilities. They mention a few names, including Desi Collings, Amy's former lover. Now, we witness individuals congregating at a volunteer center to organize a search party for Amy. Desi Collings has also shown up to lend a hand. Everyone believes that Nick doesn't seem to be grieving over his wife's disappearance. A woman and he take a selfie, which she shares online. Nick becomes tarnished in the community press as a result of all of these acts. Specifically, Ellen Abbott, a talk show host, is fervent about discrediting Nick. She calls Nick a sociopath who lacks empathy. Amy kept a journal to record their married life during their time together. According to their diary, Nick and Amy had both lost their jobs by the time they were 3 years married. Nick didn't care about Amy, even though she had given him all of her money to help. Nick became disinterested in the marriage as their bond grew weaker. He started buying new laptops and video games with excessive money. Amy claims that Nick started treating her rudely. To make matters worse, Nick and Amy were forced to return to his small Missouri hometown after learning that Nick's mother had breast cancer. According to Amy, she felt disposable and unimportant in her relationship. The diary's most startling discovery concerns an argument. According to Amy, Nick became extremely hostile after they got into a physical altercation over wanting children. Returning to the present, it has been a few days since Amy vanished. Nick is seen escorting Andy Fitzgerald, a young lady, inside Margot's home. We now know that Nick intends to file for divorce from his wife and is actively cheating on her. Nick believes Margot is still asleep, so he lets Andy sneak out the door early in the morning. But she's standing in the kitchen, yelling at her brother for misleading her. She is concerned about what might occur if the police or the media became aware of this. A vigil is kept for Amy at night. Nick attempts to appear more sympathetic and driven to locate Amy by standing with her parents. When Noelle gets to the party, she calls out to Nick and inquires as to whether he is aware that Amy is 6 weeks pregnant. This news has shocked everyone. As they escort Nick out of there, The reporters follow him all the way to the police vehicle. Margot is upset with Nick once more for not realizing this, but Nick is once again illiterate. When Rhonda, Jim, and Nick return to his house, they mention that a blood pool in the kitchen has been cleaned up. Rhonda also provides the additional proof that she has located. She shows Nick a list of recent purchases made with Amy's credit card and says Nick purchased a lot of expensive electronics and gadgets. Rhonda also questions Nick about increasing Amy's life insurance policy earlier that year. After Amy's sample results show that she was indeed pregnant, Rhonda also receives a call. Jim and Rhonda keep looking into this. They locate a nearby dealer and present him with Amy's photo. He informs Rhonda that she tried to purchase a gun from him when she stopped by. They return to the house of Nick's father and enter the basement. They discover Amy's diary inside the furnace, somewhat burned on the outside. In the meantime, Nick deciphers the third clue. He visits Margot's woodshed outside her house, where a mysterious gift box is positioned in the center of a sizable pile of electronics that are being stored. Now that the scene is set on July 5, 2012, we discover the reality. Amy is seen leaving Missouri while wearing a small bandage on her arm. She has a long list of things she needs to do in order to carry out her evil scheme. Now that we see it, she completed the task entirely. She studied police interviews and crime novels to learn how to stage a fictitious kidnapping. After that, she made friends with Noelle and began making up tales about Nick being pushy with her. While getting Nick wasted and forcing him to increase the insurance, she went online and purposefully maxed out her credit cards. In the dark, she bought her getaway car from a man she met online. After forcing Noelle to use the washroom at her house, Amy overindulged in alcohol. She pretended to be pregnant by taking Noelle's urine from the toilet. Amy staged the last part of her brilliant plan on the morning of their anniversary, while Nick drove to visit Margot at the bar. Turning the table, she started drawing blood. She splattered some on the cabinets and spilt it all over the kitchen floor. She did a poor job of cleaning it so there would be proof. In order to give the impression that the mallet was a murder weapon, she also placed some blood on it and placed it in the fireplace. Now that we know, she is attempting to frame Nick for her murder rather than just fleeing. It has now come to light that Amy has been purposefully undermining Nick for years by writing false information in the diary. All of the claims that Nick had physically harmed her were completely false, even though it was true that their marriage was failing and he was a terrible husband. The diary is still readable because she only partially burned it in the furnace. She left a clue for a treasure hunt at Nick's father's house on purpose so the police could find the diary. She dyed and cut her hair in a petrol station lavatory to hide who she was. She continued to drive farther away, making herself appear messy and untidy. When she finally arrived at a motel, she used the fictitious name Nancy to rent an inexpensive and filthy cabin. After entering, she counted her money. Since she was only making cash purchases, nobody could track down where she was or discover bank transactions made in her name. To further alter her appearance, she used a hammer in the bathroom to break her cheekbones. Back in the present, Nick and Margot are looking at the shed that is filled with electronic equipment. When they open the white gift box they carry inside, they discover Punch and Judy dolls inside, with Judy's doll lacking a mallet. This represents the fictitious mallet Amy placed in their fireplace in order to frame Nick. Nick and Margot are now aware that Amy is attempting to have Nick falsely accused of killing her. We can now see Amy at her cabin, going about her daily business. She meets Greta, her next-door neighbor, after creating a to-do list. Amy tells Greta, at the pool, how she saw Nick, on a snowy night, walking out of the bar with Andy, wiping her lips before giving her the same kiss he gave Amy when they first met. This is accurate. Nick travels to New York in the interim to locate Tanner Bolt, a lawyer who has been tracking Nick's story in the press. To help Nick establish his innocence, he consents. Greta and her friend Jeff play mini-golf with Amy at the resort. She once leaped up and dropped her cash-filled fanny pack. After noticing this, Greta and Jeff rob Amy in her room the following day and steal all of her money. Amy, who is now without money, uses a payphone to ask for assistance. Tanner travels to Missouri to assist Margot and Nick throughout this whole ordeal. Nick shares with Tanner all that he has been seeing. He explains to Tanner that the treasure hunt hints were placed precisely in areas where Amy left police-related evidence and that about her fictitious murder, Amy was always giving Nick intimate clues. In addition, Nick admits to having an affair with Andy. Tanner advises him that speaking the truth is the best course of action. Later, Nick schedules a local TV interview with Sharon Schieber. Tanner helps him learn to be truthful, own up to his affair, and win over others by acting pitiful. We watch as Amy meets her ex-boyfriend Desi Collings at a casino while Tanner gets Nick ready for the interview. She keeps emphasizing the abused wife angle while never mentioning that her money was stolen. Desi returns to his house with Amy. They watch Nick's interview with Sharon together. Nick appears regretful for the affair in a convincing way, but he is adamant that he did not kill his wife. Sharon allows him to address Amy directly into the camera. He claims to adore her. Margot notices that Nick is already receiving more love when she browses the internet. After receiving an anonymous tip that loud noises were coming from Margot's woodshed, Rhonda and other officers show up at Margot's house with a search warrant, which is when things take a bad turn. From the credit card bill, they discover all of the electronics. Nick and Margot are both placed under arrest. Nick is given a page from Amy's diary by Rhonda, which concludes, "This man may truly kill me." When Jim retrieves the missing Judy mallet from the puppets, Rhonda feels compelled to accuse Nick and put him under arrest. Tanner cuts Nick off as he tries to make his point. Amy discovers that Desi has security cameras almost everywhere in his house. She pretends to cry as she crawls to the camera while he is away at work, soaking her nightgown in wine to give the impression that she has just been physically violated. Margot and Nick are set free on bond. As they leave, the media follows them around, relentlessly hounding them since everyone believes Nick is a cold monster. Nick murmurs to himself in private. Amy waits for Desi to return home in the interim. She welcomes him into the bedroom and starts making love to him as soon as he gets there. But in the process, she uses a box cutter to murder him. It's nearly been a month since Amy vanished, and when Nick looks out his window, nothing seems to be happening. He sees Amy, still drenched in blood, in the driveway. As Amy approaches Nick, the neighbors and reporters are taken aback and start to crowd around them. She falls into his arms as he approaches. Amy makes up a tale at the hospital about Desi Collings abducting and abusing her before she makes her valiant escape. Amy plays the victim when Rhonda questions her about the technological items in Margot's woodshed. Amy ignores Rhonda's questions. The reporters, relieved that she is still alive and that Nick has been cleared, follow her and Nick home. Nick is aware that something is off, though. After washing Desi's blood off her, Amy lets him get in the shower with her to make sure Nick isn't wearing a wire. She openly admits that she killed Desi and set him up to make herself look bad and to put the blame for her entire botched scheme on the defenseless man. Later, Nick meets Margot, Tanner, and Rhonda, who has come to trust Nick. He tells them everything, but since there isn't any proof, nothing can be done. At the volunteer center, Nick and Amy make their first public appearance together while acting like a happily ever after. Afterwards, Amy presents Nick with a positive pregnancy test as a gift. Nick strikes her head against the wall, sensing that this is just another of her tricks. After learning of the pregnancy, Margot sobs for her brother because she knows he will be stuck with Amy for a further 18 years. As the movie comes to a close, Nick is seen petting Amy's hair once more and wondering aloud what her true thoughts are. To watch more awesome and thought-provoking movie recaps, please subscribe to Film Guy Recaps. Don't forget to like this video and tell us in the comments which movie you want to see next. Goodbye for now.